Welcome, everybody. So we'll do first some public comment. I don't know if there's any public comments. Any approval of the minutes? So Larry first and Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so we have a couple of our city council representatives who are running a bit behind schedule, so we're gonna skip over to an update from the Oaks Metro for the West Santa Branch corridor update. So if you guys wanna come up, great.
Thank you.
While we're walking over, I'll share, I was at the tech conference of CAA last week. It was fascinating downtown. One expert predicted that the tech sector in downtown Los Angeles in 5 years will exceed the Silicon Valley and Silicon Beach combined.
Really?
How much property downtown do you own?
These are tech people who wanna be in downtown LA.
Fantastic.
Right.
So hello, everyone. Thanks for having us out today. Thank you, Marcella. My name is Julia Brown. I'm the Metro Community Relations Manager for the Gateway Cities Region. So I'll cover this project, and I'll let Laura introduce herself, and she'll get us started.
Hi, good morning. Laura Canejo. I'm Deputy Executive Officer with Metro's Planning Department. West Santa Ana Branch is one of the projects within my unit. And I wanna thank Stella for inviting us here. We first shared a little bit of the direction we're headed in on this project during the one-on-one stakeholder briefing. And we're happy to come back and share with the entire group where we are in our next steps. there we go. Okay. Anything else to say that's covered?
No, that's that.
Okay.
Right in.
Okay. So just to remind everyone a little bit about the West Santa Ana Branch, it is a 20-mile corridor starting in the southeast part of the county in Artesia, travels through the southeast subregion through and into downtown. And so there's a number of cities, a number of stakeholders, a very diverse corridor. But there are some overarching project goals that guide the work that we carry out. One is the West Santa Ana Branch is intended to provide mobility improvements, not just for the downtown area, but also for the southeast community, and ultimately provide a connection to that part of the county, to the rest of the Metro Transit network, and to downtown. As we do this, we wanna be supportive of local land use and regional land use plans and policies, meaning that we recognize that whenever there's a rail line that comes into your community or a station, we want cities to be able to leverage those benefits and be able to develop the land around it as according to how that city sees fit and how that city thinks the station should be integrated into their community. We always strive to either completely avoid or minimize environmental impacts. We want to make sure that what the project we deliver is a project that is financially feasible, that is within budget, that it can actually get built. And then lastly, promoting equity across the corridor is important. So we are early on in our project development process. Last spring, we took to the board the alternatives analysis where we looked at a range of alignments, and ultimately the board accepted what you just saw on the map and directed us to initiate the draft environmental phase. We kicked off the draft environmental phase this last summer with the scoping period. And as you will see, as part of that, we received a number of comments, over 1,100 comments that we received during the scoping period. We had a number of meetings, and the comments that we received specific to the northern alignment area, because we received comments regarding the entire corridor. But specific to the northern alignment area, we heard from the Little Tilka community that there was concern about the elevated alignment on Alameda. We heard that there were concerns from that community about ongoing disruptions to the community due to a number of metro and city-led construction projects. We heard from the Arts District and the Industrial District as well, concerns about the aerial alignment. In addition, we also heard from a number of our sister agencies, namely High Speed Rail, MetroLink, Federal Railroad Administration, about their concern in terms of West Santa Ana Branch coming into Union Station and the potential of that project to limit their ability to also come into Union Station and be a regional rail provider. So as part of the environmental process, we need to take a look at the northern alignments. We need to be responsive to the comments we receive from the community. And as a result of that, at the end of this process, we do anticipate going back out with the rescoping in order to be compliant with the environmental process. What you see here again are the initial alignments that were shared with the community back in the summer's pre-rescoping period. So really briefly, coming up from the southeast part of the county, we would turn west onto Randolph and either travel north on Alameda or on Pacific, with all four potential alignments terminating at Union Station. All of those alignments were either aerial or a combination of bad grade and aerial, terminating just east of where the goal line platform is. Based on the comments we received, again, we had to go back to the drawing board. And as we started drawing up other potential alignments, there were a couple things that we had to keep in mind. First is what I mentioned earlier, that at the end of the day, part of this project, or one of the project goals, is to connect the Southeast communities to the rest of our network. That's a part of the community that has very limited transit or regional transit service, so we want to make sure we're providing that. We want to connect to the metro and regional rail networks. We also want to take a look at travel times and overall customer experience. We want to make sure that the travel time, ridership, transfer times, all of that is taken into consideration. Minimizing impacts. The reason why we're revisiting these northern alignments is because of the comments we received and the potential impacts of the aerial alignment. And then again, cost and schedule considerations. So what you see here are very schematic level ideas for the new northern alignments. These will be further refined as in the coming weeks and months, but I'll go over them briefly just to give you an idea of the direction Metro might be headed in as we evaluate new northern alignments. So starting on the easternmost edge, we would come up from the southeast corridor and then terminate at the arts, what we're calling the Arts District 6th Street Station, which is essentially providing a connection at Division 20. We would be responsible for ensuring that that station is accommodated as a passenger station. If this alignment were to be carried forward, we would also then take a look at how we would extend either the red or the purple line from Union Station down to that station for passenger service. So that is one of the alignments. Moving further west, we have the black, green, what looks orangish, and purple alignments that would be traveling on Alameda. We are exploring an underground alignment and terminating at different parts within Union Station. We are still exploring the opportunity to terminate east of the Gold Line platform. We're also in conversations with the Lean Us and High Speed Rail teams about whether we have what we call a stack station, so over the Gold Line station. We're also exploring underground options within the forecourt area of Union Station and exploring some other underground options in that area. As you all might be aware, it's a very tight area within Union Station, a lot going on. So we're exploring all of that. Moving further west, we have two alignments that turn towards what we're calling the downtown transit core. With these two alignments, what we're exploring is coming up from the southeast alignment, turning west so that we can somehow capture the anticipated growth that's expected in the South Park Fashion District area. And then we're looking at how do we connect either at the 7th and Metro Station or the Pershing Square Station. Again, these are very high level alignments, which is why you see very nice clean straight lines. When we come back out to the community, they won't be so straight. We'll have some suggestions about potential station locations. And also we'll have some additional information about ridership, operational challenges, engineering challenges, all of that. Those are all things that we're taking into consideration. But let me stop a moment and see if there's any questions here.
Is there a timeline on this?
Yes, you're getting a little ahead of me.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. No, that, I stopped. That's okay. But yeah, so let me just share with you. And I want to be clear, the four alignments that you saw previously, those are not off the table. The board has not made any decisions and they will not make any decisions until May. Where we are now is we are going to our board. We went to planning and programming last week. We're going to the full board next Thursday, March 1st, 9 o'clock in the morning, to seek authorization to expand the study area so that we can continue on and evaluate these new alignments that don't necessarily terminate at Union Station. From there, we will work very fast, refine these alignments, get some more technical information. We will be back out to the community in March with community meetings. At that time, these alignments will look slightly different. We will know much more about what is feasible and not feasible, and so the alignments will be refined. We will then go back to the board in May. It is at that time where we will make a recommendation about which alignments to drop from further consideration and which alignments should be carried forward into the environmental document for additional study. Yes.
So I realize you're showing the termination of, say, the Union Station. Is there a possibility where you could have a line terminate in Union Station, another line that continues up, let's say, to 4th Street or whatever one of the other streets you're going to go up, whereby it's just alternating trains with different terminations using the same system? Is that a possibility? Or is it going to be just one route and that's it?
It's one alignment. What we are looking at are options where we don't preclude future expansions or spurs off the line, let's say.
Alameda is obviously a really important street for all of us in the room, I'm sure. Did I hear you say you haven't decided yet? It's not been decided if it's below ground, ground level, or above ground?
Right. So in the original four, we showed either at grade or aerial configurations. Those are the alignments where we heard loud and clear that there were concerns about those profiles. These alignments that we're looking at would be underground.
All six or the two new ones?
So for the, as you're going through Alameda, this would be underground. We're exploring underground. We're also exploring whether there is a variation where we could be at greater aerial. On Alameda, we're exploring underground. But to get to, if we were to terminate at Union Station where the goal line station is, we would have to transition from an underground to an aerial.
Do you know where you had to pop up? Do you know about where?
We're looking at that now. We're looking at that now. And then those alignments going into the downtown transit core would be underground.
I'm sorry, say your last thing again.
So the alignments that we're showing going into the downtown transit core, we are assuming would be underground. Okay. So where we are, as I mentioned, March 1st, next Thursday, we're going to the board to seek authorization to expand the study area so we can move forward with the additional technical work we need to get some of these questions answered. We will return to the board in May. And again, it's at that time that the board will make a decision about what to keep and what to drop from further study. We are currently revising our project schedule because we want to try to keep this on schedule as we had originally proposed or accelerate that schedule. So we are refining that schedule, but I anticipate being pretty close to where we had planned to be initially. We've been busy the months of January and February going out to different community stakeholders, letting folks know what we are doing scoping, letting them know how we plan to respond. Again, I've already shared we'll be back in May. Importantly though, these are the anticipated community meetings. This assumes that next Thursday the board gives us the authorization to expand the northern study area. And so you'll see starting March 2nd, we'll have four community meetings March 2nd, the 13th, 17th, and 19th.
March 12th, 13th, 17th.
Yeah, I don't want to bring Julia out for a second. So please plan on attending one of these meetings. What we will share at that time are the refined alignments, and what we will want to hear from you is based on those refined alignments, what would you like to see carrying forward? What additional questions do you have that would need to be answered as part of the environmental document?
Do you guys even know which end you're going to start at?
No.
Is this funded with Measure M? Is there money for this?
It's funded with Measure M.
Money.
Yes, Measure M allocates funding to this project in two funding cycles. There's $1 billion in the initial funding cycle, which would be available more immediately, and then another $3 billion, I want to say 2040-ish.
Yeah. And isn't this part of the mayor's 2028?
It is noted as an aspirational 20x28 project. It's also one of the projects that's being considered for a public-private partnership.
Which would accelerate it.
Which would provide a financing mechanism to accelerate the alignment. Yeah. So what I'd like to suggest is after the Longwood community meetings, if you would like us to come back and talk in more detail about those refined alignments, we're happy to come back. Okay?
We'd be very interested in having you come back once that's accomplished. Thank you for the presentation.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay, so moving along here, we'll go into...
Joella.
Yeah,
Joella's here.
Oh, okay. Joella.
Great.
Yeah, yeah, you're ready to come on up.
So I have a few notes here. For those of you that don't know me, I'm relatively new-ish still. I'm the new downtown director for Councilmember Jose Huizar, officially starting my fourth month, so I've really kind of dove in. But our biggest issue is homeless, and I wanted to give you an update on where we're at, what's going on. The councilmember has really taken a strong approach in the last few weeks, and we're garnering more momentum in addressing the issue. So a few points I have for you, and obviously just want to clarify, this is in progress. This is all working towards the end of finding appropriate solutions and being compassionate, but at the same time being effective for our property and business owners. So with that, yesterday we had a really big meeting, the Homeless and Poverty Committee, and we had two motions that went through, and the first one was for additional resources to be allocated to sanitation to assist with the encampment cleanups. There's three districts that are 59% of the backlog of the requests. And obviously our Skid Row in downtown is part of that 59%. So we wanted, instead of the resources to be allocated equally among the 15 districts, they are by need. And sanitation has also presented a, in essence, a map, and you can see it by, it's like a heat signature map of this. So that went through, but unfortunately we also realized and learned yesterday that the process of getting additional resources on board is a significant time frame. So we also requested that they go back and see if there's a way to expedite getting additional bodies on board to fulfill that request. So they're due to come back and speak on that. The other thing that went through Homeless Committee yesterday was the council member put forth another motion that would be to have triage-like beds to address our Skid Row homeless population. Very similar to what we're doing in El Pueblo, where we're working closely with the mayor's office. That's in essence our pilot program. So we have so much attention riding on that program to ensure that not only are our merchants and our local businesses comfortable with the situation, but we're also addressing and we're learning from that so we can duplicate it There's still 2,000 people on the streets every night, so we're trying to figure out how to address that.
Can you explain the Pueblo? I don't think we're aware.
You don't know what it is. Okay, so Lot 5 is on, well, I'm not great with Russian. Yes, thank you so much. So Lot 5 is a parking lot that the city owns, and the mayor has identified that as a location that we're putting three trailers, two that do 40 beds, and that's for male, one for 20, that's for female. Secondary, the next other trailers is for services, medical, showers, bathrooms, so, and it's open 24/7. So it's not like our other missions over here that you have to leave during the day. You have access to services 24/7. And the idea is it's an emergency. I believe you go in and the intention is that you're in and moving on to bridge housing in 90 days. You can say they're up to 180 days, but the intention is at the same time sanitation is picking up their beats, if you will, on that area around El Pueblo. LAPD has put a significant amount of additional actual foot patrol down there as well. And then services, so the mayor's office, our office, as well as Supervisor Solis's office is getting involved. And it's this big coalition to help address that specific group of homeless folks that are there.
So
60 beds. It's 60 beds. Mm-hmm. So we want to do that in that smaller, like triage feeling in different places. They're talking close to $20 million to do it, to address our 2,000 homeless that are in Skid Row every night. The reason for all of this is because ultimately our goal is to enforce 5611. No tents from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. And to do that, we need to make sure we have storage, we have services, and we have the beds.
Why isn't the goal to change the law so there's no tents at all?
Step by step. Step by step. I mean, they have the right to be there to a certain extent. We need to be, you know, I understand your concerns, but everything is a step by step to make that. And correct me if I'm wrong, by us being able to enforce that, the criminal element will go down significantly. The folks that really need help will be easier to identify. The situation will greatly improve just by having that. To be able to enforce that. So our goal is we're trying to get to that point, have the beds, have it coming, the affordable housing, the yesterday also but the majority of the council members agreed to put supported housing in their areas, their respective districts to help decentralize this issue as well. So there's a lot of different arms, if you will, going on in different directions. Engine 23, which you guys might be familiar, it's over here somewhere, and I haven't been able to do a walkthrough yet personally, but that's going to become a youth center, so we're going to be having a town hall shortly on how to get the community involved there, and that's for you. Let me make sure I'm not missing anything else here. So we have El Pueblo going on, we've got different motions going on. Engine 23. Yeah, so we have, again, ultimately, that's kind of the nutshell of what's happening. But again, it's to alleviate and get to the point where we truly can go and enforce.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
When will the police be allowed to enforce 5611?
I am due to actually report back to the council member next week with a plan of action of how quickly and how much he can help us get this going, and I need to find out more of what the needs are now that this is starting to happen in progress. So I need to report back next week. So I have major homework assignments at the moment.
Is it imminent though? And then you're talking about
he should be discussing with other council members, and I would say within the next month we'll be able to push and get things going. So I should be able to report at the next meeting where we're on now.
Just one concern that I have about is just is in your planning.
Sure.
And the concern I have is it's great that we're doing this. It's great that we're taking steps. I mean, that part is wonderful. It's almost similar to what's happened down in Orange County, whereby I read some articles that were published, how people were all of a sudden now coming from outside the district because of what they were going to be providing for these people. So people that they were trying to take care of that were in that river area were going to be taken care of, and then other people were coming in trying to jump on that bandwagon. So the concern I have is something similar. All of a sudden, let's say you set up all these centers, and people are getting them off the streets, great. And all of a sudden, you've got another wave of people right behind them taking their spots.
Well, the intention is that we, at that point, have enough sanitation, health, along with LAPD, to ensure that the tents are not up during the day. And I think that's a big thing, is if they can't hang out all day in their tents doing this illegal activities and criminal element, what else are they going to be doing? Why are they coming here? Why are they hanging out? The idea of lawlessness hopefully should be, I know I say time forgotten, which would be great, but it should be, you know, not easily available to have the free market of whatever.
I hear you on that. Yeah. I'm just, like I said, it just, I can see another way that people, I mean, it's sure. Great if we can really get them to get it, put everything away, follow the law, what it's supposed to be, but I can see that. Trying to actually, I mean, it's a step-by-step process, mm-hmm. trying to get ultimate goal, obviously, they can try to get people off the streets altogether. But it's just a concern. It's just something that I worry about sometimes when we look at things like this.
Yeah. Well, I will say this. My next personal concern that I intend to, you know, I want to look at this as a holistic approach and advise the council member appropriately, is we still have the whole element of the mental health, and that's on the county side. So we're going to be reaching out to the county saying, hey, we need to work collaboratively on this, and figure out where do we need to draw attention to this specific aspect of our homeless and how to address them, not just the criminal element. So there's a lot of different arms that need to get activated, but that's...
I mean, no doubt the criminal activity by far is probably the biggest in all the problems.
Breaking down the tents, though, would be the first
thing. Yeah, that's our first step, so.
Remember, there's room for 4,000 beds in the Ola County Hospital.
I've heard that. I haven't done that research yet, so we will investigate.
Joy, I'm sorry to ask, because I was at Homeless and Poverty yesterday, I believe, before they got to the third item. Was there a discussion on the rapid response teams from sanitation?
They just presented on it, but there was no discussion on it. It was, it did go through everything.
Came through?
Yeah. So they're wanting the mayor to have that money in there.
Yeah, Joel, I was at the meeting as well, and I the plan that the council member is putting forth for parking lots in Skid Row to replicate on Pueblos and Pilot. I heard them say that there'll be a report back in 45 days.
Yes.
Okay, so in 45, and I also heard them say they were going to try to identify city-owned.
Yes.
Property.
Yes.
So within those 45 days, there will be a survey, I would assume, conducted of this area.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know of, I really am not coming up with any like surface parking lots in our bid area that could qualify for something like that.
So
are they going to look outside of just city? What are they?
The CAO's office is going, they were tasked with finding that.
Yeah,
So they want, she ultimately said 45 days so she could deliver, however, she's gonna try for earlier. Through the mayor's CENTCOM committee, they're also looking at a different avenue, which is potentially empty lots that we could potentially rent on a temporary or extended basis from private owners. To do the temporary, because the El Pueblo is slated for 3 years at the most. So if that's the case, maybe we could rent a lot from a private person, a company, whatever, and put something there. On our office side, we're looking at all of downtown and seeing what could be viable on city-owned property. And then I'm gonna be reaching out to all of the bids, and especially some of our, we're thinking maybe the southeast corner of our downtown area to see if there's other spaces down there that may be appropriate. And then I'll also look into that suggestion you made for the hospital and see. I have no idea.
Something that we talked about for 4 years. Yeah. Thank you for...
Yeah, I'm happy. I mean, I'm new. That's my job.
I know, that's great.
You know, I mean, Any other questions?
It's a huge step forward, I think. I really hope we see some impact.
I think you will. I think the commitment is there to help find solutions and work with the city, the county, private individuals to really kind of make an impact on this. Because we know our business and property owners are kind of suffocating, and we hear it, and we're trying to address it. But at the same time, we have to also serve the rest of our less fortunate and be compassionate. So we're working on it.
Thank you.
And you guys all have my contact info, I'm pretty sure. If not, Estella has it. You guys can give me a holler. Okay.
Thank you, Estella.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Estella, is this Pueblo test the only temporary test going on at this time? I thought there was another one being discussed.
There was a Chinatown being discussed, but Chinatown went away, and El Pueblo is the only one that was
only one.
The next thing, we actually just started to develop, and we're hoping it's similar, but not it's not homeless necessarily. It's a 110-101-10 task force to address with the city entities, county, that corridor, if you will, or that, I haven't come out with the right term to call it, but we're just starting to put that together. So hopefully as El Pueblo gets up and running, we'll start really pushing on all the entryways into downtown and see how we can address that.
Nice to catch Joella's briefing on me. For somebody who's new, Joella, you're pretty briefed up, so thank you for that. And really, I find it very refreshing to see that there is, you find some optimism in what's happening. I know that we've been, enduring this for quite some time now, and, to find some, little glimmer of maybe there's going to be some impact is nice to hear. But Estella also asked me to brief you on the Central Newton boundary project that the Chief of Police has been looking at, using the 10th freeway as a natural the border, so that they are in, they've done community surveys, and I don't know if any of you were contacted on that or had an opportunity to do that. The captain from Newton has done the surveys on his side, and you would not be surprised to find out that there's a lot of disconnect and disenfranchisement and a number of problems with the services that have been provided from Newton on that part of the division. The next step that we're in right now is doing a workload study on the reporting districts that would be impacted by the boundary change. And really for that, for us, that is really just looking at how we would reallocate personnel from Newton Station to Central to support the boundary change. So that is really good news that we're already in a workload study. We're close to give you an idea of how far away. I'm not exactly certain because of what's going on with the Chief of Police selection, and I don't know if the Chief of Police will make that happen before he leaves, but Chief Moore, the Director of Operations, is fully supportive of this plan. The Chief is supportive of this plan. We just want to make sure that we do it right. Because when we flip the switch for radio calls to change for different districts, for senior lead officers to be responsible for different areas, we want to make sure we get it right on that. So that is kind of the intricate and methodical work that needs to be done now on the workload study. It also not only doesn't includes police officers in black and white, I think it's maybe two senior lead officers that we would absorb, but we also have to absorb detectives for the workload of cases assigned in investigations. So there's a number of things that have to be looked at that we make sure that we carve it out correctly and support the new boundary. So that's the most up-to-date work on.
The ID under one command,
yeah.
And that's going to be most helpful. It does the same for the fashion district and for the arts district. So.
Yeah, and we've had this discussion for at least. I've been in Centerville for 3 years, and really, just it makes sense, and it's I think it will be the best for both divisions, both commands, Newton and Central. So hopefully we'll have something here soon.
Talk to us a little bit about what you do, please.
So yeah, I hope you've all been following that. You know, with the commission, there is an online survey. I know Estella's told me she's taken the survey. My family still lives in Los Angeles and Highland Park and in the Valley in Van Nuys, and they're following that. So they're following the survey. I attended the last two meetings, one last night in Montecito Heights and the other in South LA at one of the middle schools there. And you know, the turnout overall has been a little low, but the passion for the speakers has been tremendous. You know, transparency, you know, trust, someone who's a great communicator, who can work with the media, can work with the politicians but stay apolitical, understand the importance of youth programs and the impact that that has on the city. And the community safety partnerships that are going on in South LA and in Hollenbeck area and Newton, to continue forging those as best practices and models, as well as the gang reduction and youth development programs that are going on in the city. So a lot of people having an opportunity to express what they want and achieve, and I'm hopeful that you will do the same. And by way of the survey, I think the survey was really, really well done, and it gets right to the point on the priorities and characteristics that they're looking for in a chief of police. So June 27th is very close, but I'm sure the mayor will have probably three names to him probably by the end of May and the first week of June. So we're excited about the possibilities that we choose. So the city deserves someone who is passionate and understands, you know, all of the issues that are going on in the city. So, shall see.
Well, I'm going to ask a question as a deputy chief. It's been so wonderful to our community. I would hope that you're considering this as a possibility.
Yeah, well, this is my 30th year in the police department, and you know, I'm really raised in Los Angeles. I've lived in the northeast part of the division, and those of you who know me, either at work or a little away from work, you know, I love this city. You know, the good and the bad that we've been through in the last years, both as a city and as a police department. And we've been around a while, you've seen what we've endured. You know, I think we are one of the greatest, but I always think that we can be better. And I think what this department has offered me in my experience in the last 30 years, I feel you know, very qualified to be, you know, a candidate. So once the application process comes out, I definitely thanks for asking that. Very, very strong candidate pool, as you would expect. You know, this city deserves that type of interest, and internally and externally, we're going to have great candidates. So I'm sure that the mayor will have a really tough decision on his hands. Is there any other questions I can answer for you about Central? You know, thank you for, again, everything that you're doing and enduring this the issue with the homelessness and the work that's being done. You know, a lot of our work on the Central side from Reset is really devoted and dedicated to LA SAM, you know, with Operation Healthy Street. You know, we have anywhere between 4 to 6 officers really assigned to stay in close proximity as they work. I think you have apprehension about their safety, and hopefully, you know, we're able to, you know, allay that fear by being there. And the rapid response teams that Joel talked about yesterday is one of the things I will say that is really another great step is CENTCOM. These are our general managers that are in the room with the mayor, and they're having real discussions about how they can work to get to some resolution here and start having some progress that's really tangible. And so it's really a great step. The other thing is that the chief of police has met personally with the general manager for Valley Sanitation, Enrique Saldivar, and really just asked him, what can we do to help you, and, you know, be out here, you know, more often and more frequent. And everything is always resource driven, as you know, and that's what Enrique is going to the committee on to, you know, get more resources. But the chief has always pledged to him that, you know, I'll get you more cops. If you get more resources, I get you more cops, so you can get out there and continue doing the work, especially on the rapid response teams, which would be the unattended property, the bulky items, those items that, you know, contaminated, hazardous, stuff like that. So that would be another big step to help, at least with some of the really, really heavy, heavy loads on some of these sidewalks.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
I know the LA Fire Department's main responsibility, but I'm sure you're working closely with them how to prevent some of these tent fires that are so destructive to the people, mm-hmm. and of course to the buildings they're next to.
Right.
What can you give us an update on what if anything is progressing on?
No, that's a great question. I think a lot of attention was drawn to that from your executive director here. And from everything you've experienced out here with the tent fires, you know, right after we had the fires, especially those in Skirball, the rush was to put together a task force to deal with the encampments that were living in the hillsides for fires and try and abate those locations because of the dangers of extreme fire hazards, especially during red flag warnings. But nothing was mentioned about the dangers with the tent fires. But it got mentioned. So it is now incorporated into there with Chief Terrazas and Commander Choi. His counterpart now is Commander Chief Hayden in the fire department. So they worked on a plan to identify the locations first on the hillsides, but also to work on a plan within Skid Row on the visual inspection where there's propane tanks, barbecue pits, fires that are set with little butane lighters, etc. So it now is included in the plan to ensure that we are mindful of those things and addressing those things. What we're hoping to get to in this plan is to have a fire inspector merge with either a HOPE team or a RESET team. So when they are out on foot and patrol, and when they see these things, they can get out and cite, confiscate if it's a violation or a fire hazard or danger. And so thank you for that, making sure that we've been experiencing that for quite a while. And
the idea of having somebody on the HOPE team is not what you're really
doing. Well, underscore, I was going to bring that up in my report, but I'll tell you now, we've had, and it's in your package, we've had just since the beginning of this year, mm-hmm. we've had 31 fires that are directly attributable to encampments in this area.
Yeah.
And next week, Chief Terrazas, he accepted my invitation
okay.
to come and walk the district. So he is coming next week.
Okay.
And I'm going to take him to meet some of the business and property owners
okay.
who have been impacted by these fires.
Yeah, I think that's what I was talking about with CENTCOM, and Chief Terrazas is in there along with Chief Beck on those things. So there's a lot of things that are being brought to the forefront that need to be included in a number of issues citywide. But particularly down here within this district. Right. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to the maintenance report. So,
we're going to do a little presentation before we do maintenance and
Christmas.
Yes, but we're going to do a little presentation
okay.
because we've had an experience since the last time we met. Our maintenance and security working collegially together. Really in pursuit of the public safety of the area, and I just wanted to highlight that. And we have representatives here both from Chrysalis and from Allied Universal to acknowledge the work of the team members. I wanted to tell you that on February the 6th, one of our maintenance workers, Les Cross, noticed a woman vandalizing a passenger vehicle in the area of 6th and Ceres. She had a metal pipe and she was breaking the windows on a car. Pless radioed our dispatch and gave a very accurate description of the person and what she was doing. Our dispatch was then able to contact our security and send a team to look for the woman because she started to walk away from where she had committed this act of vandalism. They spotted her based on the description and started to follow her at a safe distance. Once they had a visual on her, they contacted our dispatch, who then contacted LAPD and gave LAPD all of that information. We continued to follow the woman. She kept moving from 6th and Ceres, where the incident occurred, down to 7th Street, to Gladys, to Agatha, and ultimately out to San Pedro. LAPD made contact with our officers, and we identified the suspect. The suspect then got very agitated, was very combative. The police ultimately had to use a taser on her. There was a chopper overhead. But they were able to get her into custody. And so we wanted to recognize the employees who were involved in that incident. It started with, as I said, the Chrysalis, our Chrysalis maintenance worker, Bless Cross. Our security officers, Sergeant Smith and Officer Meeks, and our dispatcher, Officer Soriano. And I know that both Chrysalis and Allied have some acknowledgement here that they want to give to the employees.
Well, on behalf of Chrysalis and the bid, I want to thank Mr. Pless Cross, a little token of the thank you from the bid. Congratulations.
Good morning. This is truly the best part of my job when we get to recognize outstanding performance by some of our security professionals. And particularly an incident like this, a lot of people don't realize these type of property crimes are extremely difficult to catch in the act. I know the chief would attest to it that these are a lot of those take a report and they're very difficult for follow-up. So for this to be dispatched, identified, dispatched, set up on, responding, I know LA appreciates it and we do as well. So a lot of times these type of crimes are associated with additional type of property crimes and sometimes crimes against persons. So outstanding job. This morning we want to recognize Paul Smith, Brianna Meeks, and Gilberto Soriano. We're going to provide you each with a $50 gift certificate for your performance. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Excellent. Great job.
Great teamwork.
Great. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, I'm going to grab my yes, and I'm Chris.
Good to see everybody again. Stella, is my timing right here?
Yes.
Okay. Good to see everybody. The last time we got together was for the end of the year. This is now wrapping up. We've been doing street maintenance since October 30 in the Skid Row District. So the biggest thing that we're here for is just to listen, take any feedback, and make sure we're implementing. Grace runs point with our Chrysalis team here at the contract, works closely with our supervisor. But we know how important this first 3 and 6 months is to make sure we get the right systems, to make sure that we're responding to anything that you guys have. So I wanted to be here to be able to hear anything from you guys. Rachel kind of fill us in on where we've been the last month, but if there's anything for you guys to bring up after she presents, I'd love to be able to implement that.
Yeah, again, Grace, Senior Operations Manager with Chrysalis. I am in the district very often, come to know it and love it as our backyard too. We're located just right outside the district. So basically, again, like Joel said, we've been here for a few months now. Just a quick reminder of the team we have in the field. So between Mondays and Fridays, we have 4 driver teams of 2. So those trucks are going around, I'm sure you've seen them, mainly doing trash abatement, trash cans, big pile cleanups, kind of looking at major hotspots. One truck dedicated at all times to service calls. So mainly pressure washing as it comes in, but also graffiti removal. And then in addition, you've got five, Monday through Friday, we've got at least five sweepers on the ground. So that's the people with pushing the carts you see coming around your stores and your properties. Thanks to Estella and the board, we've been able to keep a sixth sweeper on Mondays and Tuesdays, which has been hugely helpful. Because as you know, we've got limited services on Saturdays and Sundays. Sundays we're not here at all. Saturdays we only have two driver teams, focus again on any service calls that come in and just changing out the trash cans. So as you guys know, a lot of the donations, feedings, anyone who comes down to the district often comes on the weekends. That just naturally will produce a lot of trash. So Mondays are, you know, we tell our team they eat their Wheaties, they get a good night's sleep on Sundays because Mondays are the worst day of the week. So that extra help has been hugely, hugely helpful for our team. So hopefully we can keep that as long as possible. In addition, you guys will see the maintenance numbers that Jesse put out. I also have some reports that just show before after photos. I can put them at the end of the table if anybody would like to take them. But the biggest kind of change has been increase in pressure washing calls. So dispatch has done very well taking in all those calls, and we've done everything we can to get to them as fast as possible. Again, always looking for feedback, and feel free to call. I'll kind of pass that over to Jesse and Stella if there's more calls coming in, but that's definitely been what we've been kind of really making sure that we're doing quickly and efficiently.
Grace, can I interject?
Yeah, absolutely.
I have something that isn't in your package. I have the year numbers from comparing to last year. The pressure wash, as Grace said, is our it's a good thing that our members can call us and they know that we're right on the spot, but just to show you the increase in demand for that. Last year, we were at about, in the mid-20s, 20-some calls a week for pressure wash. In the summer, it went up to between 30 and 40 calls a week. In the fall of last year, it went up to between 50 and 60 calls a week. And now we've had this year, we've had 1 week at the end of January where we had 83 calls in 1 week. Pardon me?
Four times what we had a year.
Correct. So that's...
And Mr. Plescroft, who you all just saw, who feels like a hero today, he is one of our pressure washers. So if you see him around, he's going to be one of those drivers doing that. But yeah, so that's been kind of the biggest thing we've been learning and focusing on, and kind of the change that we've seen. The biggest thing probably to note in my time is since we last spoke, we've had two major holidays. And with those major holidays, especially in this corner of the district with a lot of the flower markets, things get a little extra dirty. So Christmas was definitely, thanks again to Estella, we got some extra hours, extra labor out there to be on, a little bit on Sunday so that we're not getting any too behind. But we saw a huge progress made for Valentine's Day, which is obviously, you can imagine, a very large flower holiday. Estella's constant connection and communication with the city has allowed them to ensure that all of those, flower marks have appropriate trash disposal places so that all that trash isn't becoming illegal dumping, being dropped, and then paid for by the bid to haul that trash away. So we put all hands on deck for Valentine's Day and the week before, making sure we were going to be covered. And, of course, there are boxes and there was an increase, but it was nothing like what I've been made to understand that you've seen in the past. So huge communication with the city, and we're super thankful for that. On the horizon, we're looking just to keep a steady, constantly getting better, constantly learning every little detail of the district and getting prepared for Mother's Day. And hopefully the trash will be just as pleasant as it was the increase for Valentine's Day.
Thank you. That's great. Guys have been doing a great job. So yeah. Really, thank you. We appreciate the improvement.
Thank you.
Any questions, any feedback?
Is there anything we're not getting? Is there anything you want of us that we can help make it easier for you to do your job?
It's a good question. I think just constant communication with Estella and with dispatch and Jesse. They're communicating everything to us. Whenever we see something out of the ordinary, we'll let them know, and the same with you guys. And if you ever feel that something's lacking, like please let us know. We want to make sure everything is being done correctly. But if we start to see any increased activity in any way, illegal dumping, we'll communicate. She'll communicate with you all.
Thank you. I would say that work around Monday and Tuesday is a huge
support
for us. Just in morale for our supervisors and to be able to accomplish the task. So I would be grateful for that.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
Great, come on up.
Good morning, esteemed members of the board, our guests. My name is Greg Foster. I'm the Director of Security in the Public Safety Division, Los Angeles Downtown Industrial District, representing Allied Universal Security Services and our Executive Director of Security East Association, Ms. Cutler. I have this pleasure this morning to give you a brief synopsis of where we are in 2018 thus far. Last we left off, I gave you an overview of the recruiting and the issues that were faced with the public safety bid. This morning, I'd like to start off with a topic that's already been raised, tent fires. The tent fires have become and are an issue for everyone in this district. We have unfortunately had a rash of tent fires that have recently caused tens of thousands of dollars of damage to merchants' property, and in one instance, an individual's vehicle was consumed by one of these tent fires. Our executive director, in a meeting, briefly stated that it would be beneficial for us to have the capacity to address these fires on the initial stage. Therefore, in February of this year, all of our public safety vehicles, as well as our maintenance vehicles, are now equipped with fire extinguishers. These have proven beneficial for us thus far, as we've been able to put out some of these fires at their very infant stages to safeguard property and to safeguard loss of life. Moving forward, we hope that the use of these fire extinguishers will lessen as we move forward, but thankful to have the capacity to do so. Second issue is my recruiting efforts. Last year I left you with some numbers, some staggering numbers of just how many candidates I've seen in the latter part of last year. Well, I have more numbers for you in the early stages of this year. The numbers 26, 13, 8, 4, 2, and 1. 26 in representation of the amount of candidates that appeared at a hiring event, the first one here at this department on January 22nd of this year. Of those 26 candidates, after a brief orientation and introduction into what it takes to be a public safety officer, 13 decided that they would take their skill set elsewhere and not move forward with this process. So that left me with 13 to pre-screen. After the pre-screening of the 13 individuals, there were 8. Of those 8 individuals, for the pre-screening process, 4 were deemed compatible to move forward with in the formal process. The formal process being the police commission vetting and the formal interview with our client. Of those 4, 2 decided at the very last moment that they themselves didn't feel they had the capacity to complete the process, so 4 went to 2. Out of the 2, I was left with 1 after this whole process was completed. So last year, between May and December, I interviewed and pre-screened 62 candidates. This year, thus far to this point, I've already pre-screened 26. It is a daunting task, to say the least, to vet the proper personnel for the Industrial District BID. This environment does not exist anywhere else in the country. This environment is problematic, and it's inclusive on more than the minuscule levels of being able to get the correct personnel and character, integrity, and the commitment necessary to perform this task. Lastly, I'd like to give a very warm thank you to Mr. Larry Roush of Los Angeles Cold Storage and his engineering staff. Last year, our hardware for our communication system malfunctioned. Mr. Roush was very gracious to allow us the opportunity to address this situation. I found out very quickly that Mr. Roush is very physically fit, as we traversed six floors of stairs more than once, with myself taking more than my shared breath breaks. But moving forward, Mr. Roush's engineering team has been instrumental, and I can't thank them enough for their help with the minor construction necessary to install our new repeaters, which I'm glad to say that system should be installed by the end of next month.
Great, glad to help.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it.
Great job, Larry.
That concludes my brief presentation to the board. Sir.
Thank you. Well done. You ended up last time with 8 of the 14, 1 out of 12. I forget the exact number. What's your staffing now?
My staffing last year was 6 at the end of the year. My staffing this year is 7. I have one auxiliary officer who is performing in a limited capacity. So I have 2 positions that I'm going to hire for. I'm going to have a hiring event here the middle of March. And if I can have a turnout as well as the one that I had prior, then I suspect that I can have a full staff.
Well, sir, I thought the Republican budget was 14 people.
No, sir. That was reduced to 10. My full staff is 10 employees.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
And Bob, that was so that we could increase the wage amount.
Good. Yeah. That's good.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I can send that application.
All right, Jim. Okay. A few things to report on from a financial standpoint. We closed the year of 2017. We still have some straggler invoices coming in for 17 services, but for the most part, we've closed the books on 17. We ended the year with about $300,000 of carryover funds. We had budgeted for $200,000, which is allowing us to keep some extra maintenance people on staff and do some other things in the district. So we're in good shape on a look forward basis for 2018, with those carryover funds being greater than we had originally anticipated. We did make some minor tweaks to the 2018 budget. After we had agreed to and voted on, it was just a minor thing on the city the city's amount of revenue was a little bit greater than we had originally budgeted, about $9,000 more. So we tweaked it a little bit in that regard. Not much of a difference, but everything else remained pretty much the same. The delinquencies we had at the end of 2017, we had about 133,000 between 2016 and 17 assessment revenue. We know we keep those carrying forward for as long as the bid is in existence. We had 105,000 for 2017, which was an unusually high amount. But what ended up happening is we didn't get information from the city until a little bit later, and they sent us about $70,000 that we just received in February. So really, we only had about $35,000 of delinquent assessments. So we're in good shape from the delinquency standpoint as well, and we got some additional funds in 2018. Also, as far as the 18 assessment revenues are concerned, we've already collected over $1 million. Actually, I take that back. We've collected about $800,000. We've invoiced for another $205,000, which we should be receiving in the next 2 or 3 weeks. So we're already off to a good start as far as our collections in 2018. We also received our general benefit income from the city in 2018, which was our 2017 general benefit income, which is another $38,000. So we've collected a very good amount of cash so far in 2018. That's the end result of all of that.
In addition, we sold one of our maintenance trucks that we used to use, that we no longer needed to use, because Chrysalis provides the vehicles as part of their contract. And we were able to get some dollars for the vehicle that we had, and we also saved a couple thousand dollars on insurance by no longer having that vehicle. So some good things have happened early on in the year from a cash standpoint, from a revenue collection standpoint, and from an overall budget standpoint. And that's about all I have to report.
Okay.
Questions?
Good.
Yeah, we're starting off the year well.
There was one other thing. That Ken and I wanted to talk to you about that's also very good news. As all of you know, the city implemented this new franchise system of trash collection. All the bids in the city have been working very hard, advocating very hard, to explain to the city that we do not collect private trash. We collect public trash that's out on the right of way. And therefore, the ordinance that brought you all into this franchise system should not apply to VIDs. So it took a lot of conversations with the city, but just about a week ago, the decision was made on the part of the city after they examined exactly what we do, again, that yes, in fact, they say that we do not fall within the ordinance. So we no longer have to contract with the franchise company, which you all now have to, NASA. So we had, that then leaves us with two choices. We can go back out into the open market like we were before, but our partners at Chrysalis proposed, since they, for the bids that they do maintenance for, a lot of them allow Chrysalis to subcontract their trash collection, thereby through economy of scale, right, they have a great leverage, can get a better deal. So just to put it in perspective, we have been paying NASA, it's only been a couple of months, because remember, they rolled in late in the year, but our December bill with NASA was over $8,000, and in January, now again, December's heavy because of the holidays, right? In January, it came down to $6,600. We were, before the franchise ordinance came into effect, we were paying roughly between $5,000 and $6,000. So it has increased under NASA. But Chrysalis has presented us with their proposal using the company that they've been using for a long time with the other bids for something that an estimate would be around $3,500 a month for us. So imagine the cost saving, and it's based on the leverage that they have, because they do this for their other bids.
And that's based on the tonnage, right, of pickup that we have. So we let you know how much we're picking
up.
They know,
yeah.
That's what they're basing it on, right?
Yep, and right. It's just a pass-through cost for us. We don't put anything on top of it, just because we do a lot of trash throughout the city of LA. We've got a pretty good price structure, so
So the reason I'm bringing it to you, other than just bringing you the good news that we're going to be able to save, we had budgeted even more this year for trash because we thought it was going to cost more under this new program. So we're going to be able to reverse that and still save some over what we were paying even before the ordinance. Now, the question to you is, in order for Chrysalis to take this over, we will have to do a modification to their contract so that this now becomes part of their charge. So we'll need to increase their contract amount accordingly to be able to pay for this. So I simply wanted to put that out as a recommendation from staff that needs to be agreed on. Okay.
I'll make a motion that we contract with Chrysalis for trash pickup and coordinate that with the stopping NASA. So that
helps with this.
Okay.
Okay. Second.
Howard. Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
And the other bit of good news is our service agreement with NASA. It's not a contract; it's just a service agreement, and the city never envisioned that you would get out of it because this is by ordinance.
Oh, so it's not a one-year contract.
No, we just call it. Jesse verified it. We can call them and cancel it immediately. So as soon as I mean, we're close to the first of the month now, so that would probably.
Yeah, right.
So just however long it takes your company to gear up, that's it, we're out of it.
So is that gonna be a separate line item on the invoice?
And we'll attach the invoice with it. Yeah, okay. So you'll see exactly this is what they charged us.
Yeah, that's fine, okay.
Yeah, and then this is a 3% raise.
Because we do record it, report it separately.
So it'll be on the first page as an additional line.
Got it. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Ken. Thank you, Stoll. So you got your executive.
I've already told you about the fires. The fire chief is coming next week.
When is that?
On Wednesday afternoon.
Is that something?
It's at 1:00. He will come here first. So any one of you that would like to come here and just thank him for being here, that would be great. You could go on the walk with us or not. Wednesday at 1:00. It would be lovely if you could be here just to thank him for coming, and then we're gonna go on our walk. In your packets, you have the map of the fires just this year, and you will see. I'm gonna take him on a route. Most of you probably saw the building here at the corner of 7th and Crocker, how badly burned it is. That property owner will meet us, and she'll talk to him about the impact there. Then I'm gonna take him down to the corner here of Agatha and Crocker, where there's a building that's been hit 3 times. And then I'm gonna walk into Town and Agatha. You'll notice on Town Avenue, just in this beginning of this year, there've already been 4 fires on Town. And one of those is the one that we caught on video. And the tenant in that building is a company that provides audio equipment for the large concerts and a lot of big events around LA. And their equipment sustained smoke and water damage. So he's gonna be there. And he said, look, you know, if this continues, there's no other place I can rent for my equipment that's as cheap as in this area. But he said, if this threat continues, I'm just gonna move out of the city of LA, and that's what I'm gonna tell him. So we've got some, better than to have a giant public meeting, I want him to see the faces and talk to the people who have been impacted. So anyway, that's Wednesday at 1:00. So we're gonna do that. And that's it.
All right, anything else? One just quick point, maybe we've done this before my time, but I just mentioned the meeting at the Central City Association. And they had some lovely, lovely brochures promoting the city and themselves. And I happened to read through one of them very carefully, and they had individual pages also promoting Little Tokyo, the Arts District, the Flower District, everybody but us. It's sort of interesting they omitted right in the middle. Everybody on the map, they have pictures of them, highlights of them.
We are the donor hole.
But we have so much goodness here. We all focus on our challenges, but might we want to someday do something to market the value, the legacy of so many of you in the room and us to remind the city of the quality of businesses and people who are here? I don't know.
And nonprofits.
Well, sure, but I just think we don't toot our own horn very often. We might have some political benefit and other reasons.
You know, we'd actually done a study at one point that we did a survey of the amount of businesses and employees we had in the area.
And
it was several thousand people, believe it or not, out of all the area. And I want to say over $2 billion of revenue to businesses. So it's significant. Okay, all right, anything else? We're good. Jordan?